क्या आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर रहे हैं और कोचिंग इंस्टीट्यूट्स को 2.5 लाख तक की फीस नहीं पे करना चाहते? अगर हाँ तो 22,500 रुपए में घर बैठ के StudyIQ के पेनड्राइव कोर्स के साथ आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर सकते हैं। आज ही विजिट करें studyiq.com।
हेलो फ्रेंड्स एंड वेलकम टू StudyIQ। इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द अमालगमेशन ऑफ three state-owned banks, namely the Bank of Baroda, Dena Bank and the Vijaya Bank. The government has recently proposed for their amalgamation. So we will see what is the proposal, what is alternate mechanism. We will see the details of the amalgamation, how it will benefit these three banks and also the banking system. And we will also discuss about the procedure by which this amalgamation will take place. Let us start. First of all, let us see what is the current affair. The government has recently proposed the amalgamation of Bank of Baroda, Dena Bank and the Vijaya Bank. These three banks are state-owned or government-owned banks, or we can say public sector banks. So the public sector banks, majority of the share will be held by the government. So these three public sector banks shall be amalgamated. That is the proposal put forward by the government. And by amalgamating these three banks, it will create India's third largest bank. And the government has said that this is a part of reforms initiated in the PSB segment. So these three banks are public sector banks, and from last year's economic survey and also various reports, it is very clear that the performance of the public sector banks are underperformed or they are not up to the mark. So the government, in order to enhance the performance of the public sector banks, government has come up with various measures. One was the recapitalization of public sector banks, that is infusion of more capital into the public sector banks. Also, the government has come up with measures to reduce the NPAs of the banks. So likewise, the government has introduced various measures in order to enhance the performance of the public sector banks. And according to the government, the amalgamation of these three public sector banks is also one such reform that is initiated in order to enhance the performance of the public sector banks. So remember, the performance of public sector banks are poor in the economy in the recent years. Now let us see what is alternate mechanism. It is a ministerial panel which is headed by the finance minister. And the decision for this amalgamation was taken at the meeting of the alternate mechanism or this ministerial panel. And it was proposed that this ministerial panel or the alternate mechanism will oversee the merger proposals of the state-owned banks. So remember, this decision for amalgamation was taken in the ministerial panel or in the alternate mechanism. Now let us look into the amalgamation. As we have discussed, three state-owned banks or three public sector banks will be amalgamated. They are Bank of Baroda, Dena Bank and the Vijaya Bank. So with this amalgamation, two well-performing banks would be absorbing a weak bank. So here the weak bank is the Dena Bank, and two well-performing bank are Bank of Baroda and Vijaya Bank. So these two well-performing banks will absorb the weak bank, Dena Bank. We will see why Dena Bank is weak bank later in this lecture. So according to the government, when these two well-performing banks absorb the weak bank, it will subsume the weaker entity. So when two strong entities absorb a weaker entity, what will happen? The weaker entity also will become stronger. So that is the idea behind this. So that is the idea behind this amalgamation. So in this context, the proposals or recommendations of Narasimham Committee 2 is relevant. Let us quickly see what were the recommendations of Narasimham Committee 2. The government had set up a committee on banking sector reforms. So the name of the committee was Committee on Banking Sector Reforms, and this was in the year 1998. So remember, this is Narasimham Committee 2. There was already another Narasimham Committee, that was Narasimham Committee 2, which was set up in 1991. So that was also a committee headed by Mr. M. Narasimham. So these two committees are popularly known as Narasimham Committee 1 and Narasimham Committee 2. Narasimham Committee 1 was known as Committee on Financial Systems, and Narasimham Committee 2, Committee on Banking Sector Reforms. So in this context of amalgamation, the committee recommendations are important. The first and the most important recommendation. Narasimham Committee 2 recommended that banks should be organized in a four-tiered structure. And in this four tiers, the first tier should be of banks which are competent at the international level. So, committee recommended that there should be at least 3-4 banks, strong banks in the economy, which will be competent in the international level. And again, tier 2, which are competent in the national level, tier 3, which are competent in the regional level, and tier 4 in the rural level. But here, tier 1 is important for us because the government is also trying to create at least 3-4 strong banks which are competent in the international level. One example is the merger of state banks into SBI. So that was one example. Now second amalgamation is going to take place with this 3 banks, and as we have discussed, this will create India's third largest banking network. Remember, this was recommended by Narasimham Committee 2 way back in 1998, and then this proposal was rejected by the government. So this is now being adopted by the government, and that is what is seen. Now the second recommendation of the Narasimham Committee 2 was that strong banks should be merged with strong banks. So this merger of strong banks will create internationally competent banks. So even this proposal was then rejected by the government in 1998. But now we see that 2 strong banks are absorbing a weak bank, and 3 of the banks are getting amalgamated in order to form a very strong banking entity. So the recommendations of the Narasimham Committee 2 seems to be very relevant from this amalgamation. So please have an idea that Narasimham Committee 2 way back in 1998 had recommended for the same. Now we have seen that 2 strong banks or well performing banks are absorbing 1 weak bank, and the weak bank is the Dena Bank. Let us see why Dena Bank is considered as a weak bank. First of all, the Dena Bank is under the prompt corrective action by the Reserve Bank of India. So what is meant by this prompt corrective action? The Reserve Bank of India will set some trigger points in order to assess, monitor and control banks, and if their performance is weak or troubled, what will the RBI do? Certain corrective action will be taken by the RBI. And this will be based on certain criteria or parameters. For example, CRAR, that is capital to risk weighted assets ratio. Second one is NPA or non-performing assets. The third parameter is return on assets or ROA. So based on these parameters, the Reserve Bank of India will measure the balance sheet strength of the banks. And if Reserve Bank of India finds that certain banks are weak or troubled in these parameters, prompt corrective action will be taken. And under this prompt corrective action, certain restrictions will be put on the banks, like expanding bank branches. Banks will not be allowed to renew or access costly deposits or to increase their fee-based income, or the banks will not be allowed to enter into new lines of business. They cannot open new branches, etc. So corrective action will be taken by the Reserve Bank of India by putting certain restrictions. And recently we have seen that 11 banks were put under the prompt corrective action by the RBI, and one bank is the Dena Bank. And we have seen that RBI will set this trigger points based on certain parameters, and we have seen that the Reserve Bank of India, the RBI will trigger this points based on certain parameters. The first one is CRAR. Now let us see what is the performance of the Dena Bank in case of these parameters. CRAR stands for capital to risk weighted assets ratio, or it is also known as CAR or capital to assets ratio. So CRAR measures the ratio of bank's capital to its risk. So the bank would have certain capital and there will be certain risk also for the bank. So the CAR of the Dena Bank is 10.6%. That means it is lesser. So the capacity of the Dena Bank to absorb risk is less. So when CAR or CRAR is less, it means that the bank's capacity to absorb risk is less. So ideally CRAR should be more or high. So if a bank has more CRAR, it means the ability of the bank to absorb its risk is high. Now, second one is NPA. NPA refers to non-performing assets. And for a bank, if the interest payment or principal amount of a loan is overdue for a period of 90 days or more, we call it as non-performing asset or NPA. And the NPA of Dena Bank is 11.04%, which is very high. Now, third parameter is the return on assets. So, return on asset means the ratio of profit of the bank to its total assets. That means how profitable is a bank or a company in relation to its total assets. By deploying the assets of the bank or that particular entity, how much profit are they able to gain? That is what is measured under ROA. And return on assets of the Dena Bank is negative, which means that they are not efficiently deploying their assets in order to earn profit. So on these three parameters, NPA, CRAR and return on assets, the performance of Dena Bank is very poor, and that is why we call Dena Bank as a weak bank. Now this weak Dena Bank will be absorbed by two strong banks, Bank of Baroda and Vijaya Bank, and by this amalgamation it will be possible to subsume the weaker Dena Bank. Now let us see, after this amalgamation, what will be the combined NPA and CRAR. So after amalgamation of these three state-owned banks, the net NPA will become 5.7%, which is lesser percentage. In case of Dena Bank, we have seen the net NPA of the Dena Bank was 11.04%, which is a very high number. So it will come down. The total combined NPA will come down to 5.7%, and capital to risk weighted assets ratio will increase to 12.25%. That means the amalgamation will create one single entity, and this one single entity will be able to absorb more risk than the single entities would individually do. Now let us analyze what are the benefits of this amalgamation. First of all, it will create stronger and globally competitive banks. India is the fastest growing economy in the world. So a fastest growing economy will need competitive and strong banks in order to boost the economic performance. And we have already seen this in Narasimham Committee too. So there should be internationally competent banks. So this amalgamation will create a stronger and a globally competitive bank. Now, secondly, it will be creating the third largest bank entity in India, and the balance sheet of this new entity will be 15 lakh crore. That means this will create a large mega bank entity. Now, thirdly, it is possible to make economies of scale. That is, cost efficiency is possible. What is meant by economies of scale? Economies of scale means when the production increases by large numbers, the marginal cost of production will come down. That means if a company or an entity is producing in large numbers, if the output is in large numbers, the cost for producing one additional unit, will be very less. That is economies of scale. That means there will be cost efficiency. Now, fourthly, there will be a rise in the customer base. The combined customer base of these three banks will be very large. So, there will be an increase in the customer base. Also, the market reach and the operational efficiency of this bank will increase because there is ease of operation, better human resources, better manpower, better technology available. So, in that way also the amalgamation will help. Now, the lending capacity of the bank will increase. The primary purpose of a bank is accepting deposits and lending. So, the most important business of a bank is lending activity. So, these three banks together will create more capital, and as the capital of the bank increases, their lending capacity also increases. They will be able to provide larger loans, loans of larger value. So these are all the benefits of the amalgamation. Now, how long will this amalgamation process take? It can take from 6 months to 1 year. So we will see what is the procedure by which this amalgamation will take place. Now, the government has put up this proposal. Now, this proposal will go to the Board of Banks. The Board of Banks will be the final authority which will make a decision in this regard. So, it is obvious that the Board of Banks will accept the amalgamation because it is a public sector bank and majority of the ownership is of the government. Therefore, the Board of Banks will go with the decision. So, first the Board of Banks will have to decide whether the amalgamation should take place or not. And after the decision, the board of banks will formulate a scheme. There should be a scheme which discusses about the process of amalgamation and all the procedures. So there will be a formulation of the scheme, and after the scheme is formulated, it will go to the parliament for its approval. So finally, when the parliament approves the amalgamation process, the three banks will stand amalgamated. So this procedure will take from 6 months to 1 year. You can find the PDF of this lecture on my Facebook page. Thank you.
क्या आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर रहे हैं और कोचिंग इंस्टीट्यूट्स को 2.5 लाख तक की फीस नहीं पे करना चाहते? अगर हाँ, तो 22,500 रुपए में घर बैठ के StudyIQ के पेनड्राइव कोर्स के साथ आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर सकते हैं। आज ही विजिट करें studyiq.com।